when I agreed to do the sermon, Pastor sent me the scripture readings for today, and nothing really hit. I mean, I just had a hard time building off the scripture reading for today. But as Mitzi stood there and read it, Matthew 10 fits right in with what I'm going to speak about. So yesterday we celebrated Independence Day, or what we now call the 4th of July. Many people today don't realize what Independence Day, the true meaning of the holiday, is. Most people think it's just a day off in July on a hot summer day to have a party and shoot off some fireworks. But we Americans are free. We're free to do about anything we want to do. Yes, we have laws in place, and many are broken. I've broken a lot of laws, just ask Doug. Growing up, he's just sitting there smiling. But just look what's going on in our world today. Especially here in the United States. We do what we want when we want. We believe what we want and who we want. We Americans take our freedom for granted. But if you really think about it, are we really free? The foundation of our freedom we enjoy has been laid out over the past 244 years. We enjoy our freedom today because of what our founding fathers, our fathers and mothers, our brothers and sisters, our sons and daughters have done to get us where we're at and to preserve our freedom. But our nation was built on Christian faith. Our freedom did not come cheap. Many have lost their lives so that we may be free. Our veterans, and there's many patriots and our veterans have fought to give us the freedom we have. And one of those things they fought for was our freedom of religion. There are those today that are trying to tell us that the intention of our founding fathers was to give us freedom from religion, not freedom of religion. But there's a difference. Are we a Christian nation today? Probably not. Was this nation founded on Christian principles? Absolutely. Today our Christian principles are being taken away from us. We Christians have been silent and starting to become the minority. Yes, Christians are still the majority in the nation, but if we continue to stay silent and not become disciples of God, then we are going to be pushed aside. The first American settlers came here to express their religious freedom or freedom of worship. The pilgrims who came to Plymouth Rock on the Mayflower wrote in the Mayflower Compact newspaper in 1620, listen to what they had to say. In the name of God, amen, having undertaken for the glory of God and for the advancement of Christian faith, do solemnly and mutually in the presence of God covenant and combine ourselves together. 23 years later, the New England Confederate was written. Listen to what our founding fathers wrote. Whereas, we all came to these parts with one, the same end and aim, namely to advance the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ and to enjoy the liberties of the gospel in purity and peace. What do we have today? Are we a Christian nation today? Are we really free? A group of people and some of our government officials are trying to eliminate not only the Word of God from public view, but also eliminate the very idea of God. They want to take one nation under God out of the Pledge of Allegiance. They want to take In God We Trust off of our money. This is a very much different idea than our founding fathers had. When the first Continental Congress met, and we're debating on how the Declaration of Independence should be written, Ben Franklin got up and said, "Gentlemen, if it is true that not one single petal fall from any flower falls to the ground without escaping God's attention, will the distress of this nation go unheeded? Let us, therefore, determine to seek His face." After having said that, 56 signers of the Declaration of Independence went to their knees and began to pray and seek God's wisdom. Can you imagine if that were to happen in our Congress and some Supreme Court today, and they all got on their knees and said, Almighty God, what do you want for this nation? Our founding fathers looked to the Word of God to organize the government and our nation. They laid the foundation, and we are to build upon it. Psalm chapter 32, verse 12 says, Blessed is the nation whose God is Lord. When our nation, including those who call themselves Christians, cease to look to God, we cease to be blessed by God. Our nation has fallen so far away from the plan our founding fathers had for this nation. Are we a Christian nation? Are we really free? The sad truth is, we Christians in America are the majority, but we are doing very little to speak out as witnesses for God. We are content to sit in our homes and nod our head and shake our heads at the direction our country is going. We are content to sit in church and worship and say amen to the sermon, but do very little outside of the church to be a witness for the Lord. Matthew 5, verse 16, Jesus says, Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Do others see this in us, the way we live our lives outside of church? God expects us to use the freedoms that our founding fathers made to be a witness for Christ in the sinful world we live in. We still live in the land of the free and the home of the brave. And why? All because our relationship with the great Creator, God Himself. God has blessed this nation. The United States is the only nation that says, God bless the USA. Other nations do not use God in their blessing. So many people pray for revival of this nation. This country and this world needs revival. But before that will happen in this country or our world, it will first have to happen in us. We as Christians need to speak up and show others how great and powerful God is. One by one, others will experience the outpouring of blessings, and once they see it in us, others will join in. Our nation has changed a lot in the past few months. Ask yourself again, are we a free nation? Are we a Christian nation? Are we really free? These are very sad and tragic and horrific times we live in today. Chaos has broken out in many parts of the world, but especially in the USA. So-called peaceful protesters are often anything but peaceful. Mob violence, destruction of property, looting, bodily injury, and killing frequently occur. The cry is for justice, freedom, and equality. The results are anything but. In the wake of such mob outbursts, we are left with extreme injustice, limited freedom, gross inequality for the victims of such violent and lawless activity. Satan is trying to take control. Sin has taken over the world. What is the meaning of all this? In John 10:10, Jesus tells us, The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come that they may have life and live it more abundantly. Whenever you see stealing, killing, and destruction, it is evident that the thief, Satan, is at work. But Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, comes to give us life. The past few weeks, mayhem has broke out across the U.S. So what is mayhem? Mayhem is the needless or willful damage or violence. Mayhem is a rowdy disturbance, a situation in which there is little or no order or control. How can we stop this mayhem? Through Jesus Christ, you can experience peace in the midst of mayhem. Jesus said in Matthew 5, verses 7 through 9, Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure at heart. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God. You can either be a peacemaker and show mercy, or you can be a troublemaker and cause mayhem. Which one are you? Are you following Jesus or Satan? How long will we Americans have to suffer before we awaken to the fact that God is trying to get our attention and return back to Him? He is calling us to return ourselves to Him before something worse happens. Our nation is doing what Ronald Reagan and other leaders of the past warned us against. Here's what they said. If we ever forget that we are one nation under God, then we will be one nation gone under. Are we a Christian nation? Are we truly free? We Christians need to do the following for our nation and for our kids' future. Humble ourselves before God. Admit we need Him. Admit we are in the wrong. Pray for economic restoration, truth in our public school systems, healing for the broken lives impacted from sin, a return to God and His teachings in our society, and for spiritual awakening. We need to seek His face, run towards God, not away from Him. Many of us need to shut off our TVs and come and pray for this nation. Many need to abandon the idols of sports and Hollywood to worship God. We need to turn from our wicked ways as Christians, let go of sin, repent, and turn 100% away from it. We need to run back into God's arms. God will hear our prayers. He will forgive us. He will heal our land, our families, our wounds, our economy, our government, and our nation. Since the coronavirus has hit, we have all had a lot of extra time on our hands. The world has pretty much shut down. What have you been doing with that extra time? Are you spending enough time with Jesus each day? Do you put Jesus first in your life? A few weeks ago, I was reading through one of the devotions, and this letter was part of the devotion. It says, "Dear friend, as you got up this morning, I watched you and hoped you would talk to me, even if it was just a few words, asking my opinion or thanking me for something good that happened in your life yesterday. But I noticed you were too busy trying to find the right outfit to put on and wear to work, so I waited. When you ran around the house getting ready, I knew there would be a few minutes for you to stop and say hello, but you were too busy. At one point, you had to wait 15 minutes with nothing to do except sit in the chair. Then I saw you sprang to your feet, and I thought you wanted to talk to me. But you ran to the phone and called a friend to get the latest gossip. I watched as you went to work. I patiently waited all day long. With all your activities, I guess you were too busy to say anything to me. I noticed before lunch you looked around. Maybe you felt embarrassed to talk to me. That is why you didn't bow your head. You glanced three or four tables over and noticed some of your friends talking to me briefly before they ate, but you didn't. That's okay. There's still more time left, and I have hope that you will talk to me yet. You went home, and it seems as if you had lots of things to do. After a few of them were done, you turned on TV. I don't know if you like TV or not. Just about anything goes on there. You spend a lot of time each day in front of it, not thinking about anything, just enjoying the show. I waited patiently as you watched TV and ate your meal. But again, you didn't talk to me. After you ate and cleaned up, I thought you would have time to talk to me, but you picked up your phone and checked all your social media. I watched as you posted about your day on social media. I waited for you to tell your friends how I blessed you today, but you were too busy posting gossip. As you did your work around the house, I waited again as you did what you had to do. At bedtime, I guess you felt too tired. After you said goodnight to your family, you plopped into bed and fell asleep in no time. That's okay. You may not realize that I am always there for you. I've got patience more than you'll ever know. I even want to teach you how to be patient with others as well, because I love you so much. A long time ago, I left a wonderful place called heaven and came to earth. I gave it up so that I could be ridiculed and be made fun of. I even died so that you would not have to take my place. I love you so much that I wait every day for a nod, a prayer, a thought, a thankful part of your heart. It's hard to have a one-sided conversation. Well, you are getting up again, and once again, I will wait with nothing but love for you, hoping that today you will give me some time. Have a nice day, your best friend, Jesus. Does that sound like each and every one of our lives? We're so busy with what's going on with the world. We worry about what other people are doing, what's on the news. We worry about how we look, how we act. We never think about Jesus. Yes, we may say a short prayer here or there, but is Jesus truly in our hearts? Is Jesus in our hearts, or is the world in our hearts? Do we take time out each and every day for God? But we're too busy that we forget about God and what He has done for us. As Christians, we need to begin to speak up about what God has done for us. So once again, are we a Christian nation? Are we really free? The answer to that question can only be found in the Bible. Jesus died on that cross so that we may be free from the sins of the world. And we know all the sins going on in the world today. But we as Christians are being silent and not speaking up. Protesters are out there speaking up for what they believe in. But we Christians need to speak up what we believe in. John 3:17 says, "For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved." The only way to be truly free is to believe what Jesus has done for us. Accept Jesus as Lord and Savior of your life. Invite Jesus into your life. Confess your sins and repent. Tell others the great news of Jesus' saving power. Only then can we be truly free. Only then can we begin to rebuild this nation as a Christian nation. So what do we need to do? Mark chapter 16, verse 15, Jesus says, "Go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature." Are we doing that? Are we doing what Jesus has told us to do? Are we preaching to everyone outside of this church property here the good news of Jesus? So are we a Christian nation? Are we really free? We can be. It all starts with each and every one of us. Amen.